Good afternoon, everyone. It's indeed a pleasure to have Sri Ram Madhav with us to deliver a lecture on India's foreign policy in the post-pandemic world order. In fact, the plan was to have him here because quite some time ago he had come when he had written a book on China. He was here in Manipal to deliver a valedictory address for one of our conferences. We thought we should have him because this semester has India's foreign policy, India's worldview, lot of courses that are associated with India and India's engagement, negotiation strategy, lot of issues that we are discussing in this particular semester. Ram Madhavji, this Department of Geopolitics and International has been there for more than a decade now. We offer master's and PhD program in geopolitics and international relations. And geopolitics perhaps is the our department is the only one in the country that offers a master's program in geopolitics, though there are international relations programs elsewhere. We've been trying to nurture students who can think and write and also help India in an India way, in the sense from an Indian perspective of we, though we use Western theories and many other things, that has been our endeavor. So far, we have been doing modestly, and as part of that one, this semester we just began yesterday. Apparently, if you remember, initially we were talking about 16th as the date, and then you had a prior committed engagement at the Naval War College in Goa, due to which we are having it today. For the benefit of audience, I would like to introduce Sri Ram Madhav. Sri Ram Madhav is an Indian politician, author and thinker who is currently serving as a member of the National Executive of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. Formerly, he has been the National General Secretary of the Bharatiya Janata Party. Sri Ram Madhav also serves as a member of the Governing Board of the India Foundation, a New Delhi-based premier think tank which seeks to articulate India's nationalistic perspective on the issues of national and international importance. We are all aware every year program that's been conducted by the India Foundation. Many of us have also attended. It does programs on counterterrorism and also on issues of foreign policy and national interest itself. Mr. Madhav has also written several books in English and Telugu, with the most recent one being Because India Comes First, Reflections on Nationalism, Identity and Culture. He writes for several publications, including the Indian Express, the Open magazine. He has also been the editor of the Bharatiya Pragna, a monthly magazine in English published by Pragna Bharati, and associate editor of Jagriti, a Telugu weekly. A voracious speaker who can speak in several languages, Ram Madhav is a familiar face for most of the people across the country. Even on international media, he has appeared umpteen number of times. He has traveled to over 30 countries and has addressed prestigious forums like the like that of Shangri-La Dialogue in Singapore, World Peace Conference at the University of Thailand, Halifax Security Forum in Canada, Second Sochi-Eurasian Integration Forum in Russia, and the BRICS Political Forum in China, amongst many others. As I mentioned, he is not a new personality or someone who requires an introduction. He is an erudite scholar in terms of his contribution from the perspective of academic contribution as well. And several of us have heard his speeches and also his thoughts on foreign policy. So today we requested him to speak on India's foreign policy in the post-pandemic world order, and he has readily agreed. Thank you, Ram Madhavji, and welcome to the Department of Geopolitics and International Relations, Manipal Academy of Higher Education. Over to you, sir.
My greetings to all the young friends, especially on the occasion of the Amrit Mahotsav of our independence. India has entered the 75th year of its independence. We will be having lots of celebrations through the year now. Both the government as well as academic and other civil society organizations will be organizing a number of events coinciding with this Amrit Mahotsav, or we also call it as, I think, Platinum Jubilee celebrations. The 75 year journey of India is actually a very inspiring journey, not only for India, but many other countries in the world. I was at an event at Goa yesterday, where I had met with representatives from four different countries from the Asian continent and also from Africa. They were all unanimous in their praise for India and its democratic system. The democracy that we nurtured in the last more than seven decades is today a shining example before the entire world. A country with such massive population, except for a minor aberration in 1975-76, when the then Prime Minister Madam Indira Gandhi had imposed emergency rule, barring that 2 years of aberration, the democracy in India has always remained a vibrant, a mature one. It gives inspiration to many other countries in the world to stick to this path or turn to this path. Why I am mentioning about this India's democratic ethos, particularly, especially now, is because the post-COVID world order, about which we are going to talk for some time now, is entering into a new phase. We are entering into a new world order post the pandemic. That new world order, which the world has already started entering, the transition is taking place at this moment. It is showing two very distinct characteristics. One of them is that because of COVID, because of the desperation, helplessness created by COVID in the general masses, people world over, in country after country, were forced to seek the help of the governments of their countries. They were forced to go and sit in the lap of their governments. Because the severity of this pandemic was such that existing institutions could not really come to the help of the ordinary citizens. The citizens were forced to seek help from the governments. In that sense, COVID has led to greater governmentalization of the polity in many countries. This has helped in governments trying to deliver, help people. Where the governments had better systems in place, like better healthcare system, better administrative mechanism, there those governments were able to help their people better. Where those systems were non-existent or weak, there, in spite of the government's efforts, people had to endure a lot of suffering. But in the process, what today appears to have happened was that some rulers in some countries have seized this opportunity of the desperation of their people, their excessive dependence on the governments due to pandemic, and those leaders tried to usurp more powers, and they are slowly turning their countries into authoritarian regimes. So one phenomena that is quite clearly discernible in the post-COVID order is the rise of new authoritarian regimes. There is growing democratic deficit visible everywhere. In 1945, the Second World War had ended. The lessons of the Second World War had helped countries turn to democratic model of governance in a big way. The rise of democracies in a number of countries began after the Second World War. One of the first countries to opt for democracy was India. The memories of the havoc caused by dictators and authoritarians like Hitler, Mussolini, and all these people was fresh in the minds of the people of a number of countries, and including India. And when we became independent, we decided that at least in our country, we will go for a vibrant democratic model of governance. In fact, to the youngsters present in this group, I want to tell you that the British rulers of that time, namely the president, the Prime Minister of Great Britain, Attlee, Clement Attlee, he writes a letter to Jawaharlal Nehru, warning him that, look, you are jumping up and down, that you will become a democracy, but democracy is not an easy model, and your country is such a big country. Those days with 350 million people, 35 crore people, and you are a country with a large illiterate population, poor population. It's very difficult for you to make this democratic model work. It will end up as an authoritarian regime. Be careful. This was the warning given by Clement Attlee to Nehru. But we decided that no, we want to be a democracy. Not because we are craving for a foreign model, but because democracy is there in the very core ethos of Indian society right from time immemorial. In fact, some of you, if you read the speech delivered by Dr. Ambedkar at the end of the presentation of the draft constitution to Constituent Assembly, it was a fantastic speech, fabulously delivered, very thought-provoking. And this speech was delivered by Dr. Ambedkar on the 25th of November 1949. That was the last day of submission of the draft constitution. In that speech, Ambedkar highlights this aspect. He says that we are going for a democratic model of governance. The reason is not that democracies are flawless, but they are definitely better than the other available systems. But more importantly, the Indian ethos right from the time of Bhikkhu Sanghas of Buddhists, or even the even more ancient times, have always been very democratic. So the ethos of this land is democratic. Hence, we can really have a successful democracy in this country. The experience in the last seven decades shows that we have presented a very glowing example of a vibrant, transparent, and largely flawless, I'm not saying it 100% flawless, but largely flawless democratic model of governance. The political maturity of our citizens is so robust that the drop of the hat, governments change in our country. So when India decided to opt for democracy in 1947, immediately after independence, it gave a lot of inspiration to many countries in the world. So country after country, as it came out of the stranglehold of the colonial rulers, immediately looked at the Indian example and opted for democracy. See, the number of democracies in the world went on growing until the 1990s. When even the erstwhile Soviet republics, which broke away from the Soviet Union in early 90s, several of them also opted to become democratic polities. Thus, we witnessed a boom, a democratic boom towards the end of the last century. So much so that even Vladimir Putin, who is currently the president of Russia. He became the president of Russia for the first time in 1999. And he became the president on pro-democracy and anti-communist plank. In fact, he made a very important, significant statement in 1999. He said the authoritarian regimes, they are transient, they are passe, they are not going to be permanent. Only democracies are intransient. Only democracies are permanent. From that stage, as we enter the 21st century and as we today overcome this COVID pandemic, the picture that we are seeing is not that encouraging or inspiring. As I said, there is a palpable, visible rise in number of authoritarian regimes in the world. Even in democracies, in some of the countries in Eastern Europe, Latin America, in Africa, so-called democracies are also throwing up authoritarian rulers. It's not happening all of a sudden. Here, it's important for us to understand the evolving global world order, the dynamic of the world order, evolving dynamic of the global order. This whole process is led again by two big powers. One of them is China, the other is Russia. It may surprise many of you that Vladimir Putin, who came to power in 1999 on the democracy plank, and insisted at that time that only democracies are permanent, not the authoritarianisms, has today, of course, turned himself an authoritarian ruler there. But he actively promotes such regimes in his neighborhood, in all the areas where the Russians have their interest linked to. Similarly, the current leadership of China, President Xi Jinping, he has made it a kind of a mission for his country to promote the China model political systems in different countries. The Communist Party of China's argument these days is that, look, authoritarianisms with efficiency are better than democracies with inefficiency and chaos. Now, on the face of it, it may appeal to several of us also here. Yes, sir, what he says is right. But remember, efficiency or inefficiency, performance or non-performance is never linked to the model of the governance alone. For example, any number of authoritarian countries, countries run by dictators, or countries run by authoritarians, are today stuck in backwardness, poverty, oppression, tensions, rioting, violence. Any number of examples are there. Similarly, democracies like Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, India, USA, we are all examples of successful, efficient, functioning democracies. So the effort to project authoritarianisms or authoritarian model of governance as the best panacea for mankind is totally a flawed argument. Yet there is a concerted effort by these two countries to create a world based on those authoritarian principles or fascist principles. Now, the other side are countries which are committed to democratic values, world peace, rule of law, internationalism, committed to those kind of universal values, led by countries like America, countries like India. These countries have a different agenda. The agenda of these countries is now how to preserve climate change, how to tackle the challenge of climate change today, how to ensure better health care for all the people of the planet, how to tackle the ever increasing role of technology in our lives, for example, issues like artificial intelligence, robotics, big data, data mining, digital currencies, how to ensure that these new technologies that are coming up in the world do not go against the basic fundamental interests of the humans. So countries with democratic ethos, liberal ethos, with universal approach, they are now striving for these agenda items, to address these agenda items on the other side. So what the post-pandemic world order will look like now is that the world again being split into two groups, a new Cold War-like situation where the authoritarian regimes promoting fellow authoritarians and the democratic regimes trying to promote issues that are of universal and global importance. Now, the last Cold War, when it was fought in Western Europe and America. So that war was essentially fought between the USSR, Soviet Union, and America. And the battlefield for them was the Pacific Atlantic region, starting with Western Europe to America. That was where the last Cold War was situated. But this Cold War is going to happen in India's own neighborhood. The Eurasian region, which is geographically to our northwest from Central Asia to Middle East to Eastern Europe to Western Europe, this entire region, North Africa, this entire region, which the Russians want to call as Afro-Eurasia, is today demonstrating the symptoms of growing authoritarianism. This region is sought to be led by both Russia and China. Let me bring in the Taliban takeover of Afghanistan yesterday. We all have seen that while America ran away, many Western countries sent special aircraft to take their people out of Afghanistan. We ourselves have brought our people back today into special aircraft. The Russians and the Chinese are happily sitting in their embassies in Kabul. Both have declared that they have no issues. They will recognize Taliban. They are ready to work with them. The whole agenda in the last several years for these two countries, as far as Afghanistan was concerned, has been only one: how to expel America from Afghanistan. They could only see a limited agenda. For them, expelling America from the Eurasian region was of paramount importance. Today, it appears that they have succeeded. America has left one of its important bastions, Afghanistan, and decided to go back. And that has given more area of influence to powers that are promoting this whole concept of Afro-Eurasia. On the other side, the Indo-Pacific is slowly emerging as the epicenter for forces of liberalism, forces committed to democracy, forces committed to rule of law, and forces committed to universal well-being. That's the reason why when we talk about Indo-Pacific, neither China nor America nor Russia would want to join with us in any of our endeavors. But for us, this region to our east, in our eastern neighborhood, is of much greater importance. The reason being, firstly, the Indo-Pacific is where the global power axis is situated today. It is here that economies of scale exist. It is here that trade happens. It is through this region that 60% of the world's container traffic passes. It is here that 50% of the energy supplies pass through. It is here that big armies are there. It is here that big markets are there. It is the most happening region of the world in 21st century. And it's in our neighborhood. Incidentally, Indo-Pacific is where India's long-term interests are very strongly linked to. We depend on Indo-Pacific for 70% of our imports. So here is a scenario where the liberal, democratic, committed to rule of law, peace, universalism, all those forces, they found the Indo-Pacific to be their playground, while those committed to promoting more authoritarianism, more strongman leadership, less of democratic values, see the Eurasian region as their playground. India happens to be at the center of these two geographical regions that are emerging in the post-COVID world order. India has to play its strategic cards very carefully, because we have our interests largely tied to Indo-Pacific region. We want to play a very proactive role in Indo-Pacific region that we cannot ignore, because as I said, our interests lie in that region more. There, India has to play a proactive role. Since this region, Indo-Pacific region, has emerged as the epicenter of global power, it has emerged as the axis of global power, many powerful countries, including USA, countries in Europe, also want to play an important role in this region. We have formed quadrilateral dialogue arrangement in which United States is there. Australia, Japan, and India are the regional partners in that. It's a good arrangement. Now, there is another body called East Asia Summit, EAS, in which besides us, all the ASEAN group of countries are there, and also several other European nations like France, Germany, UK are also there. So this region has become an active playground for forces of democracy and forces of liberalism. India will always be on that side only when it comes to deciding about which political system to follow. But while being on the right side of the divide, when history demands us to be to choose, it's important. But equally important is to ensure that this region in our neighborhood doesn't become the playground for big power politics. By big power politics, I mean the Cold War that I talked about. It should not be allowed to spill over into this region. One way to do that is for the regional powers like India, Japan, Australia, ASEAN countries like, you know, Indonesia, Singapore, South Korea, these countries to play a frontline role. What so far happened with Quad has been that America was seen as playing the frontline role. For various reasons, today, especially after the fiasco in Afghanistan, countries in, at least in our region, have their own apprehensions with respect to the Americans' ability, their commitment to the larger interests of all the powers involved in this region. There are genuine apprehensions and concerns. So as far as Indo-Pacific is concerned, it's imperative that India decides to play a proactive role together with other regional powers so that we will be in the front line. Now that takes me to the other challenge of the Eurasia, the kind of forces that are raising their heads. There, India has to play a very calibrated defensive role. There is nothing much for India to really achieve there. For example, many in our country, well-meaning people, also are criticizing Indian government for not doing enough in Afghanistan, not realizing that the situation in Afghanistan was not a standalone situation. It was a part of a greater strategic development that was taking place in Eurasian region. So India had certain limitations and certain very important constraints. So we played our role to the extent possible. We stand by the people of Afghanistan who want peace, who want liberal values, and who want democracy. We will always stand by them. But when it comes to that larger region of Eurasia, India has to play a cautious defensive role, which we are doing now. While doing that, we also must ensure that we have good friends in this region. We should not become friendless there. We have traditional relations with countries like Russia, countries like Iran. These are important players in this region. We must preserve, promote our relations with these countries in the Eurasian region. We may not agree with each and every move that those countries make. Nevertheless, when it comes to securing our interests, our bilateral relations, whether it is with Russia or with Iran, play a very important role to secure India's own interests. So friends, the evolving situation post the COVID is certainly going to throw up such a very big strategic challenge to India. It has to act in one manner towards one region and exactly the opposite manner towards the other region. It requires enormous strategic heft, strategic ability in the system, in the government. Sometimes it is unfortunate that in India, not today, but I'm talking about generally in the last 70 years, we turned out to be more romantic than strategic. We are very emotional people. We get emotionally very reactive to situations. We think that it's ideology that drives relations with other countries. We must remember, as students of international relations, you must have heard about Lord Palmerston's statement that in diplomacy, there are no permanent friends or permanent foes, there are only permanent interests. That's why people say that diplomacy is a cold-blooded business. Cold-blooded, not in the negative sense. You have to be cool. You should not be aggressive. Many diplomats don't laugh because they have to be pragmatic. They have to be realistic. So for India, that is going to be the challenge. How India plays its strategic cards well. That is the kind of very important challenge that India is going to face now in the evolving new world order. We have a strong leadership which has a vision about the country. We have thus far handled all the challenges that the country faced with utmost efficiency, utmost courage, with the experience of these challenges. We should now move forward to play a totally different and much bigger role. Tackling with immediate neighbors has been a challenge for us for many years now. Not today. You all know that our problems with Pakistan or our problems with China, they are not new. Right from the time of independence, or at least 1960s onwards, we have had problems with these two countries. And we got a lot of experience, a lot of maturity to handle those challenges. And we have continuously been upgrading our tactics while dealing with these countries. For example, take the case of China. Earlier, we used to, whenever there were incursions from the Chinese side, we used to engage in proactive diplomacy to persuade them to go back. It happened the last time in 2013 also. The Chinese had intruded into our territory, occupied some of our posts, which we used to use, they occupied them. Then we had active diplomatic deliberations with them, which had led to the Chinese going back after 20-21 days. But while doing so, they also forced Indian side to vacate a couple of posts. It was a kind of a give and take situation through diplomatic negotiations. China has a peculiar style of functioning. Its theory is, what I take is mine. What I demand is on which we should talk. This is a very peculiar style of China. What I take, it's mine. But what I demand is on which we have to deliberate. We used to fall for such a mischievous tactic in the past. But now the government has decided that it won't work that way. We will of course continue to proactively talk to them. Like, you know, right now when the standoff is going on, we have held 11 rounds of negotiations with China. We will continue to proactively talk to them, but on the ground, we will stand very strong and very firm. We shall not yield on the ground. So proactive diplomacy together with strong ground posturing is the new strategy of India. It is yielding results. Finally, the Chinese have been forced to vacate the areas that they occupied in Panganso Lake area without India not sacrificing any of its interests. Even about other two areas also, hot springs or other areas, there also we are now insisting that just like they had gone back in the Panganso Lake area, they should go back in these areas also, Dapsang Plains our hot springs area, here also they should go back. It may take time, but we are standing on the ground. 50,000 soldiers of the Indian Army are today standing eyeball to eyeball with the Chinese, asking them to go back. So these bilateral efforts at securing our interests will continue. We will successfully handle them, but the larger challenge that the post-pandemic world order is going to throw up is a totally new scenario. We should prepare ourselves for this new scenario. As I said, the new division as Afro-Eurasia on one side and Indo-Pacific on the other side, emerging as two camps, with India at the middle of the two camps, having interest on both sides. In the Eurasian side also we have our interest, in Indo-Pacific also we have greater interest. So it is a very, very difficult strategic challenge for India. We have hope that the people responsible for securing India's interests are developing India's strategic outlook in the new evolving scenario will handle it to the interest of our country. Let me thank all of you for your patient listening. I am here for some time to take some questions. Thank you and namaskar.
Thank you, sir. That was an excellent lecture. Perfect proposition to start with. I think you covered a gamut of the area that's associated with India and the type of emerging security environment and the type of regimes that we have to deal with. Extremely complex scenario that India is going through. I think also testing times. I believe never before we have seen such scenarios where past 3 days it's been the same thing that again and again all over we see, and then many of them are trying to take advantage of it. Several of them are being concerned about it. I think excellent proposition. Now we'll open the floor for certain questions. Students would be the first priority. Okay, we have Aditya Chaudhary. Sir, do you want to collect a few questions and then go ahead with, or you want to go one by one?
Let's go one by one, because otherwise I have to note down the questions.
Fine, sir. No issue, sir. Aditya, please unmute yourself, introduce and then ask the question.
Respected Rao, yeah, sir. This is myself, Aditya Chaudhary, from the second year of Geopolitics Department. Respected Ram Madhavji, firstly, I am very much thankful for your lecture. That was really very comprehensive. Sir, I have two questions for you, and the first one is related to the pandemic only, and the another one is related to the Afghanistan. So, sir, firstly, I wanted to know, like, how India can diplomatically raise the question related to the origin of the pandemic on global forums, and like, what role global leaders can play with the same. Apart from that, sir, when it comes to Afghanistan, then for sure it is a hot topic. So, sir, when we observe Taliban, there is no doubt that Taliban is a threat for India. But when we observe China, then I don't see the same situation for the China. Even what I examine is that in long term, China can use Taliban for discomforting India and the region. And also, like, China interests are highly appreciating China for providing big funding to the Taliban. So, sir, I wanted to know your opinion, like, how diplomatic Lee, India can counter this. Yes, sir.
Yes, as far as the origin of COVID pandemic is concerned, many institutions, many people are seized of that issue. Many people are raising important questions. Let those agencies try and find out the origin of it. And as far as we are concerned, we are committed to helping the humanity in COVID management by way of supplying them vaccines and all that. Let the truth come out. We also want the truth to come out. India will always be very happy to know the origins of it, because what happens is, once you know the origins of such such diseases, then you would be in a better position to find remedies. Today we are not able to find the origin, yet we are trying to find vaccines and other things as a remedy. Fair enough. So a lot of effort is going on. Let us hope and hope that the truth will come out. As far as Afghanistan is concerned, as I said, the situation has evolved very quickly. We all know that in just 4 to 6 weeks time, the Taliban has succeeded in running over the entire Afghanistan and reach Kabul and capture it yesterday. So it was a very swift development. Many in the world, not just we, were caught off guard with this development. Nobody had imagined that Taliban would so easily take over the entire country. If you recall, just last week, the Americans were saying that it would take about 90 days for Taliban to come and take over. Anyway, whatever has happened, it's in front of our eyes. Now, also important to understand is that Taliban is a group driven by a hardline theology, meaning hardline religious ideology. And there is no reason to believe that they will overnight become, fervent Democrats. They will remain Islamists. They will have their hardline ideology. But how far would they be able to implement it is something that we all have to watch and see, wait and see. Because Afghanistan of 2021 is not the same as Afghanistan of 1996. When they came to power, when the erstwhile Taliban, that was Mujahideen, came to power. So things have changed. Today, they need the support of many countries. As you rightly said, they are depending heavily on countries like China and Pakistan. Russia also wants to help them. And at the same time, they also probably need the support of America. FATF and all those things, in those issue areas also, they need support of those countries. So in this new scenario, how would Taliban prefer to behave with other countries is something we have to wait and see. So maybe instead of immediately jumping the gun and concluding that tomorrow Taliban is going to be at the doorstep of India, rather than having such hasty conclusions about Taliban, we should be on guard, no doubt, which India is doing. We are prepared for any eventuality, but we would still like to wait and see. As you very rightly said, if Taliban continues with its dreadful theological approach, if not today, tomorrow, it would become an equally serious threat to China, because they will not keep very quiet for too long about the Uyghurs in Xinjiang. Similarly, they may not like democracy flourish in Pakistan. They may want a Taliban-type government in Pakistan. They may want to see Imran Khan go. So when you bring the genie out of the bottle, you don't know what all it will do. As far as India is concerned, India knows the potential threat that can emanate from Taliban. We are prepared to face it. But at the same time, we will wait and see as to how that new regime in Afghanistan would evolve its policies, would develop its policies. So there is no need to come to any final conclusions too soon. It is too early to conclude about Afghanistan. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sri Kuttan.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, sir. It was good listening to you. So I have a few questions for you. So recently I was reading up on One China policy. So I found that you have some suggestions regarding that. And I have also seen that several people with influence in the government have been asking. And also many from the right-wing intellectuals have been asking for a change in One China policy. And I think I saw you in defiance of like India's stand, you attending the funeral of an SSF soldier too. So far, even after Chinese aggression, we have been reluctant to say anything on China in public statements or in the parliament. The country's leaders have refused to take China by name. So since we have a lot of people asking to take strong stance on China, why do you think that there is no such action or strong words being used against it? And why is there no sign that we will take in the terms of One China policy, why haven't been any action been taken on that? And secondly, you have spoken on Russia and China also. So as far as Russia is concerned, sir, why are we why have we exerted our influence properly in terms of Taliban rise, in terms of Afghanistan? Yeah, surely there are other powers playing behind. China is much more powerful and has higher stakes in some aspects. And but we have had a good relations with Qatar. We have had a friendly relations with Russia in the past, not so much in recent times. So have we played our cards right in terms of Afghanistan? And have we had a we have a strategic challenge ahead? And how do you think India will take it up? How will we face all those things? Thank you, sir.
Okay, I think answered a part of your question earlier itself, as far as Afghanistan is concerned. But remember, whether it is one China policy or our relations with countries like Qatar, Russia, as you mentioned, all these things are concerned. As I said in my speech also, we should never become romantic or ideologically emotional about these issues. We have to actually understand where does India's interests lie, where do our interests lie. So go by that. There is no bigger liberal country in the world than America. Yet look at the list of American friends. Saudi Arabia is also a friend. So why? Because certain geostrategic, geopolitical interests demand you to keep relations with different countries. Having good relations with Russia is an important aspect of India's diplomacy, because it's in the larger geostrategic interest as well as bilateral interest of our two countries. Similarly with Iran. So even on the issue of one China policy is concerned. Now, diplomacy is a continuum. So today I came to power, I will discard everything that the past governments have done. It is not like that. We have committed to one China policy several decades ago. We are still committed to it. That does not mean that when the question of interests of any other country is there before India or the liberal world, we will stand by those countries. Doesn't mean we just ignore them. So in diplomacy, sometimes you may not say everything that you do. Many things are done keeping the larger national interest and geostrategic interest in mind. While certain commitments, certain values remain, we do things outside of it. So one need not expect that on everything India should be black and white. Diplomacy doesn't work that way. There will be some gray areas. There you maneuver. You keep that maneuverability by keeping those gray areas, not just about India. All countries practice diplomacy in that manner only. Thank you.
Janardhan?
Yeah. Can I add something?
Just a second, Janardhan. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Actually, it was a question. So if I had to take it at the last, that's also fine. Let the others go before.
Maybe let's give chance for the others and you can come back after these three. Thank you. Janardhan.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for such an enlightening lecture, sir. My doubt is, sir, you have after your lecture got over, I was just pondering over that India is in a juncture where we need a lot of strategic thinking, and even we need to develop in our economic front. So what is your view, or any particular friends which you have recognized for India to go forward in the post COVID world order, because of this pertinent threats that we are facing and the very extreme kind of geopolitical situation we are facing? And the second thing is, sir, I was also concerned with, caught my attention was when you said that India, in terms of China, we have already doing things which were not being done in the past. So we being stationing our troops, and whereas we used to do diplomatical concessions before. So how is the government playing out in that area? Thank you so much.
As I said, we need to be very proactive diplomatically now. India, under at least the present government under Prime Minister Modi, has been following a very proactive diplomacy, proactive diplomatic endeavor. Earlier about India, the world used to say that number one, Indians are romantic. Number two, they are very reticent. Romantic in the sense that if you remember, when the world was divided into two camps, one was the Soviet camp, the other was the American camp, communist and capitalist camps. We decided to remain non-aligned. We decided that we won't join this camp or that camp. But actually we created a third camp called the non-aligned camp. So what was that non-aligned camp? It had no agenda of its own, neither here nor their camp. Okay, it served our purpose for some time. But when the Russian attack happened, nobody from non-aligned movement were ready to stand by you, because non-aligned cannot be an agenda. You should have some agenda items for countries to come together. So we had a different type of approach. Today also sometimes our policymakers now talk about things like commonwealth, revival of commonwealth. There is nothing common in the commonwealth countries anymore, and there is no wealth in any case. We still call it as commonwealth. Will it serve us? No, but it was created some 60 years ago. Why not revive it? So sometimes we fall for such approaches. I'm not saying they are wrong or they were wrong. They served some limited purpose. But today's situation demands a much more calibrated strategic approach for India. Fortunately, under our Prime Minister's leadership, we are able to play that proactive role today. We have become an important player in Indo-Pacific, at least. We are today working with a number of countries, with the Australians, with, of course, Japan ke saath hamara, our relationship is very old, and the Americans and we are working together. And most importantly, we recognize the centrality, the central role, the pivotal role that the ASEAN group of countries play. So we take the ASEAN group of countries, the 10 countries of ASEAN group, also on board. We have strong ties with them. We have a 25-year diplomatic relations with ASEAN. So that relationship we are strengthening further. The result is we have emerged as a very important frontline power in the Indo-Pacific. I mentioned to you about the significance of Indo-Pacific in my speech. So that we have done under the leadership of Prime Minister Modi. But at the same time, our security challenge emanates from Eurasia. It is here that India has to walk on a very tight rope. It requires much more calibration, much more patience, and much more strategic thinking. Here, we have some friends, like we have Russia, we have Iran, who are friends, but we have very serious threats in the form of China, Pakistan, the new Taliban regime in Afghanistan. Some of these forces are very inimical to our interests. So India has to make a very calibrated strategy when dealing with these areas, which we are doing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Vajra?
Good evening, sir. My question is regarding what you mentioned about our traditional allies, Russia and Iran. What I believe that our alliance, a growing alliance with the US, has somewhat alienated these two countries. So how do you propose we navigate this situation, especially since Iran has growing influence in the Arab world, and they're also a nuclear power? Thank you, sir.
Those countries understand India's geostrategic requirements, geostrategic needs. They know that while we have a strong or growing trade relationship that also extends to procurement of defense equipment with America, they nevertheless also know that the relationship between India and those countries has also been traditionally very robust and strong. Now, whether it is Russia or even Iran, they also have had their own relations with the US. Under Obama, the Iranians had almost arrived at an agreement between the two countries. It's another matter that President Trump came and he turned it upside down. He simply rejected that agreement. Had Obama continued or had another Democrat regime come in 2017 in America, probably Iran and US would have by now become friends. I mean, these are hypothetical scenarios I'm saying. So they also understand that countries, for their geopolitical, geostrategic needs, maintain relationships. As far as India is concerned, we are clear that we are not in any camp per se. Yes, we have moved closer to America because there are many common aspects between our two countries. We are two strong democracies committed to rule of law, a peaceful world order. But then we have strong military ties with Russia. Even to this day, 60-70% of our hardware spare parts for Indian military come from Russia. We have such enormous dependence on that country. And recently, we have purchased S-400 anti-missile platforms from Russia for some $20 billion at the cost of some $20 billion. So similarly, with Iran, our relationship until very recently was a strong relationship of trade. We used to procure oil from them and we used to serve them in infrastructure and many other areas. We have built the Chabahar port in Iran a few years ago. So they know that while India, for its own geostrategic, geopolitical interests, wants to have good and strong, robust relations with America, in this region, we are friends with these countries also, that they are aware. They also know that India is not in any camp per se. Thank you.
Yeah, Akhil.
Good evening, sir. Sir, with your lecture, I have two questions in mind. It's regarding the economic front. So my first question is, with a failure of multilateralism in the ongoing pandemic, how should India approach the current state of multilateral institutions? And my second question is, with a 15th G20 summit, India's motto was is collaborate to create. So how does this link with India's foreign policy plan to strike a balance between globalization and self-reliance? Thank you, sir.
So first of all, the new world order that is emerging post the COVID pandemic will have multilateralisms like G20 you talked about, G7. These are all multilateral bodies, Shanghai Cooperation Organization, East Asia Summit. The multilateralism will be there, but together with that, minilateralisms will be there. Quad is a minilateral of only four countries. There will be microlateralisms where a tiny country will now champion an agenda. A small country will take up an agenda and it will tie up with two, three countries and they will start pursuing that agenda. This mini-lateralism or microlateralism will also be the feature of international relations in the coming years and decades. So it's going to be a very, very fascinating type of thing that you will be facing. Because the important point that you must understand is that we have already entered a heteropolar world. So for some of you, this will be a new phrase, new word rather. We have heard about multipolarity. Several countries or groups of countries emerging as poles in the world. But today, beyond this multipolarity, there are forces that are not necessarily guided by any laws of any land and any one country or a group of countries. They are also rising. For example, the big tech in the world, they are powers by themselves. they have more following. Some of these big tech have more following than heads of the nations, whether it's Amazon or Google or Facebook. They are much bigger than nations. So big tech, terror groups like Taliban, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, NGOs. Today, it is the age of global NGOs. They defy geographical boundaries. You have a phenomenon of lone wolves who will make and unmake the futures of countries. So all these forces, religious organizations are becoming very big. They are actually influencing the politics of nations. In Latin America, in Colombia, a long pending dispute between the government and an underground guerrilla organization was resolved not by President Trump, but by Sri Sri Ravishankar of Art of Living. So that is the kind of new world we have entered into, where heteropolarity is the order of the day. There will be many players crisscrossing each other. So be prepared for a very fascinating journey. As an international relations student, you will have lots of very interesting phenomena rising in the international relations area. India, as a big country, has to tackle all these things. You have to be there in multilateral arrangements. That's why we are hosting G20 next year. We are there in G7. We are also there in Shanghai Cooperation Organization. We are there in the mini laterals like Quad. We have our own micro laterals between India, Nepal, and Bangladesh. It's called BBIN. So we will be doing many things simultaneously. That is why I said the foreign policy and diplomacy is actually evolving into a very fascinating idea. You are students of it. You will really enjoy knowing more about it. Thank you.
Yeah, we have to close by 4:15. Quickly, Gargi, no comments, but only quick direct questions.
Good evening, sir. I'm Gargi, a second year student of the department. Dearly grateful for that enriching lecture. My question is, now that Afghanistan is ruled by Taliban, Afghans in large numbers are fleeing away and seeking refuge in other countries. Sticking to the topic, I want to understand your standpoint whether India will put nation, civilizational heritage and population demographics first, or will allow refuge to Afghans belonging to non-minority community given India-Afghan relations. Thank you.
It is an evolving challenge for not just India, for many countries. The immediate neighbors of Afghanistan are actually facing the major brunt of it, like Central Asian republics are seeing a large-scale exodus into their countries. Similarly, Iran is also getting a good number of refugees. Some of them who can catch the flights are flying out of Afghanistan to wherever those flights take them. So far, India has not really witnessed any big prospect of an exodus into India. Having said it, if some such thing happens after some time, when air services restored, if some such thing happens, obviously, how to handle it, we have to definitely think, because you must remember that people of Afghanistan have enormous goodwill for India. You mentioned about nine minorities. As far as the Afghanistan minorities are concerned, they are either Hindu or Sikh. When they come seeking shelter, India has to respond positively. There is no option for India. But even those non-minority Afghans, if they seek Indian support, in what way we can extend our support is something that India will definitely look at with an open mind. Because as I said, the ordinary people in Afghanistan have great hopes on India. They love India. They actually want an India type like system to come to their country. It's another matter. They unfortunately get totally opposite type of system. So coming to a question, when such a situation, such an eventuality arises, right now that eventuality is not there because there are no air services. And you know that we don't share land borders with Afghanistan. We share, but that area is under Pakistan occupation. So right now that is where we stand. Let us see how the situation evolves.
Kiran Kumar.
Good evening, sir. I'm Kiran from the second year in the department. My question is, what is your opinion on the human-centric globalization approach that India is putting forth in the post-pandemic world order?
Yes, as I said, one of the new agenda items before the mankind post the pandemic would be the role of technology. We are seeing technology evolving with very rapid speed. Areas like artificial intelligence, robotics, data mining, these areas are growing very fast. They have the potential to influence the behavior of individuals, not only individuals, even communities, societies, and nations. It's a very serious challenge. So issues like how do we ensure that while technology is important, artificial intelligence is important for the mankind, how do we make sure that these machines tomorrow they don't guide the mankind, mankind guides the machines. Machines become supplementary to mankind for in its pursuit for happiness, in its pursuit for development, not the other way. Not the tail wagging the dog. So those are the kind of challenges that we have to face. So what Prime Minister Modi has been saying, human-centric development, the meaning of it is this, that we have to go for technologies, we have to opt for newer technologies, we have to progress in all these areas, but ultimately the central issue should be human development, development of man, development of humanity, not just the development of machines. For example, in the warfare, we use drones today. The Americans use drones today to kill terrorists. But each drone is controlled by somebody sitting in Chicago or Atlanta. They are unmanned machines, but controlled by a human brain. But today's artificial intelligence says there's no need for that human brain to control. The artificial intelligence can guide this drone to go and decide whom to kill, whom not to kill by itself. Do we want that kind of a system where machines decide what to do, what not to do, or man decides? So that is where this whole question of human-centric development becomes very, very important and relevant. It's not just a philosophical question. It is a question related to our day-to-day life. Tomorrow's our life and death is in the hands of this. This question will answer that whole thing. So human-centric development that we are talking about is a serious thing. Otherwise, you know, what will happen is these new areas, artificial intelligence, robotics, instead of becoming aids in man's progress, they will become the 21st century nuclear bombs. When nuclear bomb was invented, first we dropped it on those two cities in Japan. Then we came to know that it is harmful to the humans, by which time millions had perished. So we need to be careful about our technologies. That's what we are saying. It's not against technologies. Technologies, chahiye, they are important for man's progress. They are a part of man's evolution. But man should be the master of the technologies, not the other way. Thank you. Nandkishore ji, I think we should end here.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are just ending, sir. We'll have a formal vote of thanks. Ms. Aishwarya also had the same question which you already answered when Ms. Gargi asked for. I would request, without wasting much time, I would request my colleague Dr. Anand to deliver a formal vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Nandkishore. It's my pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks in this distinguished online lecture. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Sri Ram Madhavji for coming to and delivering this lecture for the students of the Department of Geopolitics and International Relations. Yours being one of the initial set of distinguished online lectures in this semester, I think it is a really good start. And I think going by the questions, the way you can see actually the way the students were really enthusiastic and understanding, as well as the lot of thought which have been created in their minds as a result of your viewpoints and your arguments. So thank you, sir, for providing a very overall comprehensive picture about the post-pandemic world order and India's foreign policy in this context. Thanks for taking your very valuable time out for the department, and we would like you to come here, as Dr. Nandkishore has mentioned, once the pandemic situation is much more, you know, better, so that we can have much more better close interactions with you. I would also like to thank Dr. Nandkishore for taking the initiative in for this distinguished online lecture and providing the leadership for making it possible. In this context, I'd also like to thank Dr. Dhanasri, who is the coordinator of this event, and as well as my other faculty colleagues. I would also like to immensely thank the student community who has turned up in big numbers, actually more than in their hundreds. And they have very actively participated by raising very pertinent questions on the topic which we were discussing. And I think actually it I think this is the way to go when it comes to interacting with eminent people like Sri Ram Madhav. They have very limited time to speak what they to speak whatever they know of, and it's only through these questions and answers that we actually get more out of more knowledge and wisdom out of them. So thank you, students, especially the students of Department of Geopolitics, and also I see a lot of students from Manipal Institute of Communication also come in, as well as the other outsiders who have turned up for this lecture. And with that, I would like to thank everyone, and hope we'll all meet again once more, if not in the online form, but hopefully in the offline manner. So thank you all. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir. Visit us once again.